I bet you're worried.
We were worried.
We were worried about vaginas.
Well, we're worried what we think about vaginas. And even more worried that we don't think about them. Well, we're worried about our own vaginas. They needed a context of other vaginas. A community, a culture of vaginas. There's so much darkness and secrecy surrounding them, like the Bermuda Triangle. Nobody ever reports back from there.
In the first place, it's not that easy to even find your vagina. Women go weeks, months, sometimes years without looking at it. A high-powered businesswoman was interviewed, and she said she was too busy. She didn't have the time. Looking at your vagina, she said, is a full day's work. Gotta get down there on your back in front of a mirror that's standing on its own, full length preferred. You've gotta get in the perfect position with the perfect light, which is then somehow shadowed by the mirror and the angle that you're at. You get all twisted up. You're arching your head up, killing your back. You're exhausted by then. She said she didn't have the time. She was busy.
So, there were the vagina interviews, which became the Vagina Monologues. Over 200 women were interviewed. Older women, young women, married women, lesbians, single women, college professors, actors, corporate professionals, sex workers, African American women, Asian American women, Jewish women, Caucasian women, Hispanic women, Native American women. Okay, at first, women were reluctant to talk. They were a little shy. But once they got going, you couldn't stop them. Women secretly love to talk about their vaginas. They get very excited, mainly because no one's ever asked them before.
Let's just start with the word vagina. It sounds like an infection at best, maybe even a medical instrument. Hurry, nurse, bring me the vagina. Vagina, vagina. Doesn't really matter how many times you say it. It never sounds like a word you want to say. It's a totally ridiculous, completely unsexy word. If you try using it during sex, trying to sound politically correct, darling, could you stroke my vagina? That's it, to kill the mood right there.
We were worried about vaginas, what we call them and don't call them.
In Great Neck, New York, they call it the pussycat. A woman there told me, her mother used to tell her, don't wear panties underneath your pajamas, dear. You need to air out the pussycat.
In Westchester, they call it a pookie.
In New Jersey, a twat. There's powder box, a poochie, a poopy, a peepee, a poopaloo, a punani, a pal, and a peach.
Tootie.
Dee Dee.
Nishi.
Dignity.
Monkey box.
Coochie snarcher, cooter, levy.
Gladys Ziegelman. VA, wee wee, horse spot, nappy dugout.
Mongo, Mookie, a pajama, funny boo, marshmallow. A gauli, possibly, tamale, tutita, connie.
A mimi in Miami.
A split knish in Philadelphia.
A shmende in the Bronx.
A shtot in Armenia.
Backpack in the Philippines.
Gud in Bengal.
A punzi in Hungary.
Gyrla in Icelandic.
Kiska in Russian.
Chut in Hindi.
Pashasha in Portugal.
Puti in Nepal.
We are worried about vaginas. Woo!
Woo-hoo! Some of tonight's monologues are based on one woman's story. Some of the monologues are based on several women's stories surrounding the same theme, and sometimes a good idea became an outrageous one. This monologue is based on one woman's story. Although this subject came up in almost every interview and was often fraught, this subject being hair.
Oh my God.
You cannot love a vagina unless you love hair. Many people do not love hair. My first and only husband hated hair. He said it was cluttered and dirty. He made me shave my vagina
It looked puffy and exposed, and like a little girl.
This excited him. When he made love to me, my vagina felt the way a beard must feel. It felt good to rub it, and painful. Like scratching a mosquito bite. It felt like it was on fire. There were screaming red bumps. I refused to shave it again. Then my husband had an affair. When we went to marital therapy, he said he screwed around because I wouldn't please him sexually. I wouldn't shave my vagina. The therapist had a German accent and gasped between sentences to show her empathy. She asked me why I didn't want to please my husband, why I wouldn't shave my vagina. I told her, I thought it was weird. I mean, I felt little when my hair was gone down there, and I couldn't help but talk in a baby voice, and my skin got all irritated, and even calamine lotion wouldn't help. She told me, marriage is a compromise. I asked her if shaving my vagina would stop him from screwing around. I asked her if she had many cases like this before. She told me, questions diluted the process. I needed to jump in. She was sure it was a good beginning. This time, when we got home, he got to shave my vagina. It was like a therapy bonus prize. He quipped it a few times and there was a little blood in the bathtub, but he barely noticed it because he was so happy shaving me. Then, when he was pressing against me, I could feel his spiky sharpness digging into me, my naked, puffy vagina. There was no protection. There was no fluff. I realized then that hair is there for a reason. It's the leaf around the flower, the lawn around the house. You gotta love hair in order to love a vagina. You cannot pick the parts you choose. And besides, my husband never stopped screwing around.
All of the women were asked the following questions.
If your vagina got dressed, what would it wear?
Glasses.
A beret.
A leather jacket.
Silk stockings.
Mink.
A pink boa.
A male tuxedo.
Jeans.
Something form-fitting.
Emeralds.
An evening gown.
Sequins.
Armani only.
A tutu.
See-through black underwear.
A taffeta ball gown.
Something machine washable.
A eye mask.
Purple velvet pajamas.
Angora.
A red bow.
Ermine and pearls.
A leopard hat.
A silk kimono.
Sweatpants.
A tattoo.
An electric shock device to keep unwanted strangers away. High heels.
Lace and combat boots.
Purple feathers, twigs, and shells.
Cotton.
A pinafore.
A bikini.
A slicker.
If your vagina could talk, what would it say? Two words.
Slow down!
Is that you?
Feed me. I want.
Yum yum.
Oh yeah.
Start again.
No, over there.
Lick me.
Stay home.
Brave choice.
Think again.
More, please.
Embrace me.
Let's play.
Don't.
Stop.
More. More.
Remember me?
Come inside.
Not yet.
Wow, Mama.
Yes. Yes.
Rob me.
Enter at your own risk.
Oh, God.
Thank God.
I'm here.
Let's go.
Let's go.
Find me.
Thank you.
Find you.
Too hard.
Don't give up.
Where's Brian?
That's better.
Yes! There! There! Woo!
A group of women between the ages of 65 and 75 were interviewed. These interviews were the most poignant, possibly because many of these women had never had a vagina interview before. One woman, who was 72, had never even seen her vagina. She washed herself in the shower and bath, but never with conscious intention. She had never had an orgasm. At 72, she went into therapy, as they do in New York. And with the help of her therapist, she went home one afternoon by herself, lit some candles, took a bath, played some music, and she got down with herself. She said it took her over an hour because she was arthritic. But when she finally found her clitoris, she said she cried. This monologue is for her.
Down there? I haven't been down there since 1953. No, it had nothing to do with Eisenhower. No, no, it's a cellar down there. Very damp, clammy. You wouldn't want to go down there, trust me. You'd get sick. Suffocating. Very nauseating. The smell of the clamminess and the mildew and everything, whew, smells unbearable. Gets in your clothes. No, there was no accident down there. It didn't blow up or catch on fire or anything. It wasn't so dramatic. Well, I mean, no, never mind. I can't talk about this. What's a smart girl like you going around talking to old ladies about her down there for anyway? We didn't do this kind of thing when I was a girl. What? Jesus. Okay. There was this boy, Andy Leftkoff. He was very good looking. Well, I thought so. And he was tall, like me, and I really liked him. He took me out on a date in his car. No, I can't do this. I can't talk about down there. You just know it's there, like the cellar. There's rumbles down there sometimes. You can hear the pipes, and things get caught down there. Little animals and things, and it gets wet. And sometimes people have to plug up the leaks. Otherwise, the door stays closed. You forget about it. I mean, you know it's there, but you don't see it and you don't think about it. It has to be there, though, because every house needs a cellar. Otherwise, the bedroom would be in the basement. Oh, Andy. Andy Leftkoff, right. He was very cute. He was a catch. That's what we used to call it. We were sitting there in his new white Chevy Bel Air. I remember thinking that my legs were too long for the seat. I have very long legs. And they were smushed up against the dashboard, and I was looking at my big kneecaps when Andy just kissed me in this surprisingly take me by control like they do in the movies kind of way. And I got excited. I got so excited that, well, there was a flood down there. I couldn't control it. It was like this force of passion, this river of life that flooded right out of me, right through my panties and right onto the car seat of his new white Chevy Bel Air. It wasn't pee and it was smelly. Well, frankly, I didn't smell anything.
what Andy said. He said that it smelled like sour milk and that it was staining his car seat. I was a stinky, weird girl, he said. I wanted to explain that his kiss had caught me off guard, that I wasn't normally like this. I tried to wipe up the flood with my dress. It was a new yellow primrose dress and it looked real ugly with the flood on it. Andy took me home without saying another word, and when I got out and closed his car door, I closed the whole shop. Locked it, never opened for business again. I dated some after that, but the thought of flooding just made me too nervous. I never even came close again. I used to have dreams though, crazy dreams. Oh, no, they're dopey. Why? Burt Reynolds. I don't know why. Burt never did anything for me in real life, but in my dreams, it was always Burt and I, Burt and I, Burt and I. It was always the same general dream. We'd be out at one of those restaurants, the kind you see in Atlantic City. All big with the chandeliers and thousands of waiters with the vests. Burt would get me this orchid corsage and I'd pin it on my blazer. We'd be laughing, laughing, laughing. We'd eat huge shrimp, fabulous shrimp. We'd laugh some more. We were very happy together. Then he would look into my eyes and pull me towards him in the middle of the restaurant. And right as he was about to kiss me, the whole restaurant would start to shake. Pigeons would fly out from under the table. I don't know what those pigeons were doing there. And the restaurant would fill with my flood. There'd be fish inside it, and little boats and things. And Bert would be standing waist deep in it, looking horribly disappointed in me that I'd done it again. Horrified as he watched his friends, Dean Martin and the likes, swim past us in their tuxedos in the evening gowns. I don't have those kinds of dreams anymore. Not since they took away everything connected with down there. Moved out the uterus, the tubes, the whole works. The doctor thought he was being funny. He said, if you don't use it, you lose it. But really, I found out it was cancer. Everything connected with down there had to go. Who needs it anyways? It's highly overrated. I've done other things. I love the dog shows. I sell antiques. You asked me what would it wear? What kind of question is that, what would it wear? It would wear a big sign. Closed due to flooding. What would it say? I told you, it's not like that. It's not like a person who speaks. It stopped being a thing that talked a long time ago. It's a place you don't go. It's locked up under the house. It's down there. You happy now? You got me to talk. You got it out of me. You got an old lady to talk about her down theres. Do you feel better now? You know, actually, you're the first person I ever told about this. And I feel a little better.
My vagina is a shell, a round pink tender shell, opening and closing. Closing and opening. My vagina is a flower, an eccentric tulip, the center acute and deep, the scent delicate, the petals gentle but sturdy. I didn't always know this. I learned this in the vagina workshop. I learned this from a woman who runs a vagina workshop. A woman who believes in vaginas. A woman who really sees vaginas, who helps other women see their own vaginas by seeing other women's vaginas. In the first session, the woman who ran the workshop asked us to draw a picture of our own unique, beautiful, fabulous vaginas. That's what you call it.
She wanted to know what our own unique, beautiful, fabulous vagina looked like to us. One woman who was pregnant grew a big red mouth, screaming with coins spilling out. Another very skinny woman drew a big serving plate with a kind of Devonshire pattern in it. And I drew a huge black dot with a little squiggly lines around it. And this black dot was equal to a black hole in space, and the little squiggly lines were supposed to be people or things or your basic atoms that get lost there. I always thought of my vagina as an anatomical vacuum randomly sucking up particles and objects. In the workshop, we were asked to look at our vaginas with hand mirrors. And then, after a careful examination, we were to verbally report back to the group what we saw. And I must tell you that up until this point, everything I knew about my vagina was based on hearsay or invention. I had never really seen the thing. It had never occurred to me to look at it. My vagina for me existed on some abstract plane, and it just seemed so reductive and awkward looking at it like we were in the workshop on our mats with the mirrors. It reminded me of how the early astronomers must have felt the primitive telescopes. I found it quite unsettling at first, my vagina. Like the first time you see a fish cut open and you see this other bloody complex world inside right underneath the skin. And it was so raw, so red, so fresh. But what surprised me the most was the layers. Layers inside layers, opening to more layers. My vagina amazed me. I couldn't even speak when it came to my turn in the workshop. I was speechless. I had awakened to what the woman in the workshop called vagina wonder. I just want to lay there on my mat, spreading my legs and examining my vagina forever. It was better than the Grand Canyon. Ancient and full of grace. It had the innocence and the freshness of a proper English garden. It was funny, very funny. It made me laugh. It could hide and seek and open and close. Then, the woman in the workshop asked how many women in the workshop had had orgasms. Two women tentatively raised their hands. I did not raise my hand, but I had orgasm. I didn't raise my hand because they were accidental orgasms. They happened to me. They happened in my dream and I'd wake up in splendor. They happen a lot in water, mostly in Bath, once in Cape Cod. They also happen on horses, on bicycles, sometimes at the treadmill in the gym. I didn't raise my hand, but I had had orgasms because I didn't know how to make one happen. I thought it was a mystical, magical thing, and I didn't want to interfere. It felt wrong getting involved. Contrived, manipulative, it felt Hollywood. And, you know, the surprise would be gone and the mystery. But the problem was, of course, that the surprise had not been there for 2 years and that I hadn't had that magical accidental orgasm in a long time, and I started to feel frantic. That's why I was in the vagina workshop. And then, the moment had arrived that I both dreaded and longed for. The woman who ran the workshop asked us to take out our hand mirror again and see if we could locate our clitoris. We
we were there, the group of us women, searching for our spots, our locus, our reason. And I don't know why, but I started crying. Maybe it was sheer embarrassment. Maybe it was knowing that I had to give up this fantasy, this enormous life-consuming fantasy that someone or something was going to do this for me, that someone was coming to lead my life, to choose direction, to give me orgasms. I could feel the panic coming. The simultaneous terror and realization that I had avoided fighting my clitoris had rationalized it as mainstream and consumerist because I was in fact terrified that I did not have a clitoris. I was terrified that I was one of those constitutionally incapables, one of those frigid, dead, shut down, dry, apricot tasting, bitter, oh my god. The panic I felt. I lay there on my mat, searching for my spots, reaching my fingers, and all I could think about was the time when I was 10 and I lost my gold rings with emeralds in the bottom of the lake. How I kept diving over and over the bottom of the lake and reaching my fingers, running it over through this fish and stones and slimy stuff and fish. But never my ring. I know I'd be punished. The women who ran the workshop saw my insane scrambling and sweating and heavy breathing, and she came over and I told her, "It's gone! It's gone! I've lost my clitoris! I should have avoided swimming!" The woman laughed. She calmly stroked my forehead and she told me that my clitoris was not something I could lose. It was me, she said, the essence of me. It was a doorbell to my house and the house itself. I didn't have to find it. I just had to be it. Be it. Be my clitoris. Be my clitoris. I lay back and I close my eyes. I put the hand mirror down. I watch myself floating above myself. I watch as I slowly began to approach and re-enter. I felt like an astronaut re-entering the surface of the Earth. It was very quiet, this re-entry. Quiet and gentle. I bounced and landed and bounced. I came into my own muscles and blood and cells, and then I slid into my vagina. It was suddenly easy and I fit. I was all warm and pulsing and young and ready and alive. And then, without looking, with my eyes still closed, I put my hand on what has suddenly become me. There was this little quivering at first, which urged me to stay. And then this quivering became a quake, an eruption, and layers dividing, subdividing, and then the quake broke off into silence of light and ancient and colors, and that broke off into a plain of music and colors and innocence and longing. And I felt connection, calling connection as I lay there thrashing about on my little blue mat. My vagina is a shell, a flower, and a destiny. I am arriving as I'm beginning to leave. My vagina, me.
happy fact. This is from Woman, an Intimate Geography by Natalie Anjé.
The clitoris is pure in purpose. It's the only organ in the body designed purely for pleasure. The clitoris is simply a bundle of nerves, 8,000 nerve fibers, to be precise. That's a higher concentration of nerve fibers than is found anywhere else in the male and female bodies, including fingertips, lips, and tongue. And it's twice the number in the penis. Who needs a handgun when you've got a semi-automatic?
As part of Eve's work to include the voices of all women who face violence, she interviewed a diverse group of transgender women in preparation for this piece. Her idea to transform this wide range of experiences into a Greek chorus was an elegant way to give the many voices a feeling of one voice united. Punishing the feminine was an overarching theme of the interviews, and this can take many forms. Some women in the transgender community face violence from a very early age because they are so feminine or because they show inappropriate interest in things considered to be feminine. Others experience violence at a much later age because they are not feminine enough. For those who do not pass gender, often get pushed to the fringes of society, especially when they are the youngest and most vulnerable. Yet, they stay true to their hearts, despite every attempt to break their spirits. This monologue moves from childhood through adversity and into the maturity, wisdom, and joy of affirming who they are. Women who face a difficult road just to claim the name. In the end, they endure, they survive, and they share in the pride of expressing femininity with all women in one voice, united.
At 5 years old, I was putting my baby sister's diapers on. I saw her vagina. I wanted one.
I thought
it would grow.
I thought I would open. I ached to belong. I ached to smell like my mother. Her sweet aroma lived in my hair, on my hands, and my skin. I ached to be pretty. Pretty.
I wondered why I was missing my bathing suit top at the beach. Why I wasn't dressed like the other girls. I ached to be completed. I ache to belong, to twirl the baton.
They assigned me a sex the day I was born. It was as random as being adopted or being assigned a hotel room on the 30th floor. It has nothing to do with who you are or your fear of heights. But despite of the apparatus I was forced to carry around, I always knew I was a girl.
They beat me for it. They beat me for crying. They pummeled me for wanting.
To touch.
To pet.
To hug.
To help.
To hold their hands.
For trying to fly in church like Sister Petra.
For doing cartwheels.
Crushing socks.
For carrying purses to kindergarten.
They beat the shit out of me every day on my way to school.
In the park, they smashed my magic marker painted nails.
They punched my lipstick mouth.
They beat the girl out of my boy.
Or they tried.
So I went underground. I stopped playing the flute.
Be a man. Stand up for yourself. Go punch him back.
I grew a full beard.
It was good. I was big.
I joined the Marines. Suck it up and drive on.
I became duller.
Jaded.
Sometimes cruel.
Butch it up.
Always clenched. Inaccurate, incomplete.
I ran away from home.
From school.
From boot camp.
Run to Miami.
Greenwich Village.
Aleutian Islands.
New Orleans.
I found gay people.
Wilderness lesbians.
Got my first hormone shot. Got permission to be myself.
To transition. To travel. To immigrate. 350 hours of hot needles. I would count male particles as they died. 16 men hairs. Gone.
The feminine is in your face. I lift my eyebrows more. I'm curious. I ask questions.
And my voice. Practice, practice. It's all about resonance. Sing song, sing song. Men are monotone and flat. Southern accents are really excellent. Jewish accents really help. Hello, my friend.
And my vagina is so much friendlier now. I cherish it. It brings me joy.
Orgasms come in waves. Before, they were jerky.
I'm your girl next door.
My Lieutenant Colonel father ended up paying for it. My vagina.
My mother was worried what people would think of her that she made this happen until I came to church and everyone said, you have a beautiful daughter.
I got to be soft. I am allowed to listen. I am allowed to touch. I am able to receive.
To be in the present tense.
People are so much nicer to me now.
I can wake up in the morning, put my hair in a ponytail.
A wrong was righted.
I'm right with God.
It's like when you're trying to sleep and there is a loud car alarm. When I got my vagina, it was like someone finally turned it off.
Now I live in the female zone. But you know how people feel about immigrants. They don't like it when you come from someplace else. They don't like it when you mix. They killed my boyfriend. They beat him insanely as he slept with a baseball bat. They didn't want him dating a foreigner, even though she was pretty and she listened and was kind. They didn't want him falling in love with ambiguity. They were scared he'd get lost. They were that terrified of love.
With a man.
This is how I came to love my vagina. It's embarrassing because it's not politically correct. I mean, I know it should have happened in a bath with salt grains from the Dead Sea, and you playing, me loving my woman self. I know this story. Vaginas are beautiful. Our self-hatred is only the internalized repression and hatred of the patriarchal culture. It isn't real. Pussies unite. I know all of it. Like, if we grew up in a culture where we were taught that fat thighs were beautiful, we'd all be pounding down milkshakes and Krispy Kremes, lying on our backs, spending our days thigh expanding. But we didn't grow up in that culture. I hated my thighs, and I hated my vagina even more. I thought it was incredibly ugly. I was one of those women who looked at it, and from that moment on, I wished I hadn't. It made me sick. I pitied anyone who had to go down there. So in order to survive, I began to pretend there was something else between my legs. I imagined furniture. Cozy futons with light cotton comforters, little velvet settees, leopard rugs, or pretty things, silk handkerchiefs, quilted pot holders, place settings. I became so accustomed to this that I lost all memory of having a vagina. Whenever a man was inside of me, I pictured him inside a mink-lined muffler or a Chinese bowl. But then I met Bob. Bob was the most ordinary man I have ever met. He was thin and tall and nondescript and wore khaki tan clothes. Bob did not like spicy food. He did not listen to Prince. He had no interest in sexy lingerie. In the summer, he spent his time in the shade. He didn't share his inner feelings. He didn't have any issues or problems, and he wasn't even an alcoholic. He wasn't very funny or articulate or mysterious. He wasn't mean or unavailable. He wasn't self-involved or charismatic. He didn't drive fast. All right, I didn't particularly like Bob. I would have missed them all together if he didn't hand me back my change I dropped on the deli floor. When he handed me back my quarters and pennies and his hand accidentally touched mine, something happened. I went to bed with Bob, and that's when the miracle occurred. It turned out that Bob loved vaginas. He was a connoisseur. He loved the way they felt, the way they tasted, the way they smelled, but most importantly, he loved the way they looked. He had to look at them. The first time we had sex, he told me he had to see me. "I'm right here," I said. I think he was a weirdo and freaking out in the dark. He turned on the light and then he said, "Okay, I'm ready. I'm ready to see you. Right here. I'm right here." Then he began to undress me. "What are you doing, Bob?" "I need to see you," he said. "No need," I said, "just do it." "I need to see what you look like." "But you've seen a red leather couch before." Bob continued, he would not stop. I wanted to throw up and die. This is awfully intimate, I said, "can't you just do it?" "No," he said, "it's who you are. I need to look." I held my breath, he looked and looked. He got all breathy and his face changed. He didn't look ordinary anymore. He looked like a hungry beast. "You are so beautiful," he said. "You're elegant and wild and innocent and deep. You saw that there?" It was like he read my palm. "I saw that," he said, "and more, much, much more." He stayed looking for almost an hour, as if he were studying a map, observing the moon, staring into my eyes, but it was my vagina. In the light, I watched him looking at me, and he was so genuinely excited, so euphoric and peaceful, I began to get wet and turned on. I began to see myself the way he saw me. I began to feel beautiful and delicious, like a great painting or a waterfall. Bob wasn't afraid, he wasn't grossed out. I began to swell, began to feel proud. I began to love my vagina, and Bob lost himself there. And I was there with him, in my vagina, and we were gone.
My vagina's angry.
It is. It's pissed off. My vagina's furious and it needs to talk. It needs to talk about all this shit. It needs to talk to you. I mean, what's the deal? An army of people out there thinking of ways to torture my poor ass, gentle, loving vagina? Spending their days constructing psycho products and nasty ideas to undermine my pussy? Vagina motherfuckers. All this shit they're constantly trying to shut up us, clean us up, stuff us up, make it go away. Well, my vagina's not going away. It's pissed off, and it's staying right here. Like tampons. What the hell is that? A dry wad of fucking cotton stuffed up there? Why can't they find a way to subtly lubricate the tampon? As soon as my vagina sees it, it goes into shock. It says forget it. It closes up. You need to work with my vagina. Introduce it to things. Prepare the way. That's what foreplay is all about. You gotta convince my vagina. Engage my vagina's trust. You can't do that with a dry water fucking cup. Stop shoving things up me. Stop shoving and stop cleaning it up. My vagina doesn't need to be cleaned up. It smells good already. Don't try to decorate. Don't believe them when he tells you it smells like rose petals. When it's supposed to smell like pussy. That's what they're doing. Trying to clean it up, make it smell like bathroom spray or the dark. All those douche sprays. Floral, berry, rain. I don't want my pussy to smell like rain. All cleaned up. It's like washing a fish after you cooked it. I want to taste the fish, that's why I ordered it. Then there's those exams. Who thought them up? There's gotta be a better way to do those exams. Why the scary paper dress that scratches your tits and crumbles when you lie down so you feel like a wad of paper someone threw away? Why the rubber gloves? Why the flashlights all up there like Nancy Drew working against gravity? Why the Nazi steel stirrups, the mean cold duck lips they shove inside you? What's that? My vagina is angry about those visits. It gets defended weeks in advance. It won't go out of the house. Then you get there. Don't you hate that? Scoot down. Relax your vagina. Why? So you can shove mean cold duck lips inside it? I don't think so. Why can't they find some nice, delicious purple velvet and wrap it around me? Lay me down on some feathery cotton spread, put on some nice friendly pink or blue gloves, and rest my feet in some fur-covered stirrups. Warm up the duck lips. Work with my vagina. But no, more tortures. Dry water, fucking cotton, cold duck lips, and thong underwear. That's the worst. Thong underwear? Who thought that up? Moves around all the time, gets stuck in the back of your crusty butt. Vagina's supposed to be loose and white, not held together. That's why girls are so bad. We need to move and spread and talk and talk. Vaginas need comfort. Make something like that, something to give them pleasure. But no, of course they won't do that. Hate to see a woman having pleasure, particularly sexual pleasure. I mean, make a nice pair of soft cotton underwear with a French tickler built in. Women would be coming all day long. Coming in the supermarket, coming on the subway, coming happy vaginas. They wouldn't be able to stand it, seeing all those energized, not taking shit, hot, happy vaginas. If my vagina could talk, it would talk about itself. Like me. It would talk about other vaginas. It would do vagina impressions. It would wear Harry Winston diamonds. No clothing, just there, all draped in diamonds. My vagina helped release a giant baby. It thought it would be doing more of that. It's not. Now, it wants to travel, doesn't want a lot of company. It wants to read and know things and get out more. It wants sex, it loves sex. It wants to go deeper, it's hungry for depth. It wants kindness. It wants change. It wants silence and freedom and gentle kisses and warm liquids and deep touch. It wants chocolate. It wants to scream. It wants to stop being angry. It wants to want. It wants. My vagina. Well, it wants everything.
Bosnian women refugees were interviewed during the war in Yugoslavia in refugee camps and centers. 20 to 70,000 women were raped in the middle of Europe as a systematic tactic of war. It was shocking to see how little people did to stop it. But then again, according to a report published by the EU Fundamental Rights Agency in 2014, 1 in 3 women in the EU had suffered physical and/or sexual abuse since the age of 15, which is another kind of war. This monologue is based on one woman's story. We do it tonight for that woman and for the extraordinary women of Bosnia and Kosovo.
My vagina was green. Water soft, pink feels. Calm wooing, sun resting, sweet boyfriend touching, lightly, with soft piece of blonde straw. There's something between my legs. I do not know what it is. I do not know where it is. I do not touch. Not now, not anymore, not since. My vagina was chatty. Can't wait. So much, saying words, talking. Can't quit trying, can't quit saying, oh yes, oh yes. Since I dream, there's a dead animal sewn in down there with thick black fishing line. And the bad dead animal smell cannot be removed. And his throat is slit and it bleeds through all my summer dresses. My vagina, singing all girls' songs, all goat bell ringing songs, all wild autumn field songs, vagina home songs. Not since the soldiers put a long, thick rifle inside me, so cold the steel rod canceling my heart. Don't know whether they're going to fire it or shove it through my spinning brain. 6 of them, monstrous doctors with black masks shoving bottles up me too. There were sticks and the end of a broom. My vagina, swimming river water, clean spilling water, over sun-baked stones, over stone clit stones, over and over. Not since I heard the skin tear and made lemon screeching sounds, not since a piece of my vagina came off in my hand, a part of the lip. Now one side of the lip is completely gone. My vagina, a live, wet water village. My vagina, my hometown. Not since they took turns for 7 days smelling like feces and smoked meat. They put their dirty sperm inside me. I became a river of poison and pus. And all the crops died. And the fish. My vagina. A live, wet water village. They invaded it, butchered it, and burnt it down. I do not touch now, do not visit. I live someplace else now. I don't know where that is.
my short skirt is not an invitation. A provocation, an indication that I want it or give it, or that I hook. My short skirt is not asking for it. It does not want you to rip it off me or pull it down. My short skirt is not a legal reason for raping me. Although it has been before, it will not hold up in the new court. My short skirt, believe it or not, has nothing to do with you. My short skirt is about discovering the power of my lower calves, about cool autumn air traveling up my inner thighs, about allowing everything I feel or pass or see to live inside. My short skirt is not proof that I am stupid or undecided or malleable little girl. My short skirt is my defiance. I will not let you make me afraid. My short skirt is not showing off. This is who I am before you made me cover it or tone it down. Get used to it. My short skirt is happiness. I can feel myself on the ground. I am here. I am hot. My short skirt is a liberation flag in the women's army. I declare these streets, any streets, my vagina's country. My short skirt is turquoise water with swimming colored fish, a summer festival in the starry dark, a bird calling, a train arriving in a foreign town. My short skirt is a wild spin, a full breath, a tango dip. My short skirt is initiation, appreciation, excitation. But mainly, my short skirt and everything under it is mine. Mine. Mine.
In hundreds of interviews with homeless women over the course of 13 years, only one woman was not sexually abused as a little girl or raped as a young woman. For most of these women, home is a very scary place. A place they have fled. The shelters are ironically the first place many of them ever find safety, protection, or comfort. This is one woman's story as she told it, but what isn't in the story is the fact that this woman met another woman in the shelter, and they fell in love. And through their love, they both got out of the shelter system.
Memory, December 1965, 5 years old. My mama tells me in a scary, loud, life-threatening voice to stop scratching my coochie's nurture. I become terrified that I've scratched it off down there. I do not touch myself again, even in the bath. I'm afraid of the water getting in and filling me up so I explode. I put band-aids over my coochie to cover the hole, but they fall off in the water. I imagine a stopper, a bathtub plug up there to prevent things from entering me. I sleep with three pairs of happy heart pattern cotton underpants underneath my snap-up pajamas. I still want to touch myself sometimes, but I don't.
Memory, 7 years old. Edgar Montaigne, who is 10, gets angry at me and punches me with all his might between my legs. It feels like he breaks my entire self. I limp home. I can't pee. My mama asks me what's wrong with my coochie snorcher, and when I tell her what he did to me, she yells at me and says never to let anyone touch me down there again. I try to explain that he didn't touch it, mama. He punched it.
Memory, 9 years old. I play on the bed. bouncing and falling, and impaled my coochie snorcher on the bedpost. I make high-pitched screaming noises that come straight from my coochie snorcher's mouth. I get taken to the hospital, and they sew it up from where it's been torn apart.
Memory, 10 years old. I'm at my father's house, and he's having a party upstairs. Everyone's drinking. I'm playing alone in the basement, and I'm trying on my new white cotton bra and underpants that my father's girlfriend gave me. Suddenly, my father's best friend, this big man Alfred, comes up from behind and pulls my new underpants down and sticks his big hard penis into my coochie snorcher. I scream, I kick, I try to fight him off, but he already puts it in. My father's there then, and he has a gun. And there's a loud, horrible noise, and there's blood all over Alfred and me. I'm sure my coochie snorcher is finally falling out. Alfred is paralyzed for life, and my mama doesn't let me see my father for 7 years.
Memory, 13 years old. My coochie snorcher is a very bad place. A place of pain, nastiness, punching, invasion, and blood. It's a place for mishaps. It's a bad luck zone. I imagine a freeway between my legs, and I'm traveling, going far away from here.
Memory, 16 years old. There's this gorgeous 24-year-old woman in our neighborhood, and I stare at her all the time. One day, she invites me into her car. She asks me if I like to kiss boys, and I tell her I do not like that. Then, she says she has something to show me, and she leans over and kisses me so softly on the lips, with her lips, and then puts her tongue in my mouth. Wow. Then she asks me if I want to come over to her house, and then she kisses me again and tells me to relax, to feel it, to let our tongues feel it. She asks my mama if I can spend the night, and my mother's delighted that such a beautiful, successful woman has taken an interest in me. I'm scared and I can't wait. Her apartment's fantastic. She's got it hooked up. It's the 70s, the beads, the fluffy pillows, mood lights. She makes a vodka for herself and she asks me what I want to drink. I say the same as she's drinking, and she says she doesn't think my mama would like me drinking vodka. And I say she probably wouldn't like me kissing girls either. And the pretty lady makes me a drink. Then she changes into this chocolate satin teddy. She's so beautiful. I always thought bull daggers are ugly. I say, you look great. And she says, so do you. I say, but I only have this white cotton bra and underpants. Then she dresses me slowly in another satin teddy. It's lavender, like the first soft days of spring. The alcohol has gone to my head and I'm loose and ready. There's a picture of a naked black woman over her bed with a huge afro. She gently and slowly lays me out on the bed, and just our bodies rubbing makes me come. I'm so hot, so wild. Then she does everything to my coochie snorcher, which I always thought was nasty before, and wow. I'm so hot, so wild. She says, your vagina, untouched by man, smells so nice, so fresh. Wish I could keep it that way forever. I get crazy wild, and then the phone rings. And of course, it's my mama. I'm sure she knows. She catches me at everything. I'm breathing so heavy, and I try to act normal when I get on the phone. And she asks me, what's wrong with you? Have you been running? And I say, no, mama. Exercising. Then she tells the beautiful lady to make sure that I'm not around boys. And the lady tells her, trust me,
There's no boys around here. Afterwards, the gorgeous lady teaches me everything about my coochie snorcher. She makes me play with myself in front of her and tells me all the different ways to give myself pleasure. She says always to know how to give myself pleasure, so I'll never need to rely on a man. In the morning, I'm worried that I've become a butch because I'm so in love with her. She laughs, but I never see her again. I realize later she was my surprising, unexpected, and politically incorrect salvation. She transformed my sorry ass Gucci snorcher and raised it into a kind of heaven.
We've created a map of vagina-friendly cities. Welcome, Budapest! That was really weak, guys. Can we try it again? Welcome to Budapest! They're wild for vaginas in Pittsburgh. In fact, a woman from Pittsburgh was obsessed about a particular word, a pejorative word used to describe the vagina. Her mission was to reconceive the word.
I call it cunt.
Woo!
I've renamed it cunt. I really like it. Cunt. Listen to it. Cunt. C, C. Ka, ka. Cavern. Cackle. Clicked. Cute. Come. Closed. Closed. Inside. Inside. Ka. Then you, then Q, then curvy, inviting sharks can you. Uniform, under, up, urge, you. Then N, then cun, snug letters fitting perfectly together. N, nest, now, nexus, nice, nice, always depth. Always round in uppercase. Con, con, a jagged, wicked, electrical pulse. And soft, warm, con, con. Then T, then sharp, certain, tangy T. Texture, take, tent, tight, tantalizing, tensing, taste. Tendrils, time, tactile, tell me, cunt, cunt, say it, cunt, cunt. Tell cunt. Me, cunt. 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 Cunt,
a 6-year-old girl was asked, if your vagina got dressed, what would it wear?
A red high tops. And Matt's cap, worn backwards.
And if it could speak, what would it say?
It would say words that starts with B and C. Turtle and violin examples.
What does your vagina remind you of?
A pretty dark peach. Or a diamond I found from a treasure, and it's mine.
What's special about your vagina?
Somewhere deep inside, it has a really, really smart brain.
Woo! And what does it smell like?
Snowflakes.
Sex workers have a rich, compelling, and complex relationship with their vaginas. This particular woman blows my mind. She's a sex worker, but she only does sex work with women.
I love vaginas.
I love women. I don't see them as separate things. Women pay me to dominate them, to excite them, to make them come. I didn't start out like this, no. To the contrary, I started out as a lawyer. But in my late 30s, I became obsessed with making women happy. It began as a mission of sorts, but then I got involved in it. I got very good at it, kind of brilliant. It was my art. I started getting paid for it. It was as if I had found my calling. I wore outrageous outfits when I dominated women. Lace and silk and leather. And I used props. I loved props. Whips, handcuffs, rope, dildos. There was nothing like this in tax law. There were no props. There were no props. No excitement. And I hated those blue corporate suits. Although, I wear them now from time to time in my new line of work. And they serve quite nicely. There were no props in corporate law. No wetness, no dark, mysterious foreplay, no erect nipples, no delicious mouths. But mainly, there was no moaning. Not the kind I'm talking about, anyway. This was the key I see now. Moaning was the thing that ultimately seduced me and got me addicted to making women happy. When I was a child and I would see women in the movies making love, making these strange orgasmic moaning noises, I used to laugh. I got strangely hysterical. I couldn't believe that big, outrageous, ungoverned sounds like that came from women. I longed to moan. I used to practice in front of my mirror on a tape recorder, moaning in various keys, various tones. But always when I played it back, it sounded fake. It was fake. It wasn't rooted in anything sexual, really. Only in my desire to be sexual. But then, when I was 10, I had to pee really badly once on a car trip. It went on for almost an hour. And when I finally got to pee in this dirty little gas station, it was so exciting, I moaned. I moaned as I peed. I couldn't believe it. Me in a Texaco station, in the middle of Louisiana, moaning. I realized then moans are connected with not getting what you want right away, with putting things off. Moans are best when they caught you by surprise. They come from this hidden, mysterious part of you that's speaking its own language. I realized moans were, in fact, that language. I became a moaner. It made most men anxious. Well, frankly, it terrified them. I was loud, and they couldn't concentrate on what they were doing. They'd lose focus, then they'd lose We couldn't make love in people's homes. The walls were too thin. I got a reputation in my building, and people stared at me with contempt in the elevator. Some men thought I was too intense. Others called me insane. I began to feel bad about my moaning. I got quiet and polite. I made noise into a pillow. I learned to choke my moan, to hold it back like a sneeze. I started getting headaches and stress-related disorders. I was becoming hopeless when I discovered women. I discovered most women loved my moaning. But more importantly, I discovered how deeply excited I became when other women moaned, when I was responsible for other women moaning. I made love to quiet women, and I found this place inside them, and they shocked themselves in their moaning. I made love to moaners, and they found a deeper, more penetrating moan. It was a kind of surgery, a kind of delicate science, finding the tempo, the exact location or home of the moan. That's what I called it. Sometimes I found it over a woman's jeans. Sometimes I snuck up on it, off the record, quietly disarming the surrounding alarms and moving in. Sometimes I use force, but not violent, oppressing kind of force. More like a dominating, I'm gonna take you someplace, don't worry, lay back and enjoy the ride kind of force. Sometimes it was simply mundane. I found the moan before things even got started. While we were eating salad or chicken, just casual, just right there with my fingers, here it is like that, real simple in the kitchen, all mixed in with the balsamic vinegar. Sometimes I use props. Well, I love props. Sometimes I made the woman find her own moan in front of me. I waited, stuck it out until she opened herself. I wasn't fooled by the minor, more obvious moans. No, I pushed her further, all the way into her power moan. Now, there's the clit moan. I. The vaginal moan. Oh, oh. The combo clit vaginal moan. I. Oh. The almost moan. The right on it moan. Oh, right there. The elegant moan. Oh. The brace slick moan. Oh, 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 yeah. Then there is the wasp moan. The mountaintop moan. Yo, lucky. Baby moan. Ooh, ee, ooh, ah, ooh. Then there's the doggy moan. The uninhibited, militant, bisexual moan. The machine gun moan. The tortured zen moan. The diva moan. The CEU student moan. I should be studying. Finally, the surprise triple orgasm moan. Oh yeah. Oh yeah. That's good. Right there. Oh, oh.
Without any mention of birth. This was a bizarre omission, but then again, a male journalist recently asked, what's the connection? Our author, Eve Ensler, was present for the birth of her granddaughter. She was in awe of vaginas before that moment. She's in deep worship now.
I was there when her vagina opened. We were all there, her mother, her husband, and I, and the nurse from Ukraine with her whole hand up there in her vagina, feeling and turning with her rubber glove as she talked casually to us, like she was turning on a loaded faucet. I was there in the room when the contractions made her crawl on all fours, made unfamiliar moans leak out of her pores, and still there after hours when she just screamed suddenly wild, her arms striking at the electric air. I saw her vagina change from a shy, sexual hole to an archaeological tunnel, a sacred vessel, a Venetian canal, a deep well with a tiny stuffed child inside waiting to be rescued. I saw the colors of her vagina. They changed. Saw the bruised, broken blue, the blistering tomato red, the gray pink, the dark. Saw the blood like perspiration along the edges. Saw the yellow, the white liquid, the shit, the clots pushing out all the holes, pushing harder and harder. Saw through the hole the baby's head. Scratches of black hair. Saw it just there behind the bone. A hard, round memory as the nurse from Ukraine kept turning and turning her slippery hand. I was there when each of us, her mother and I, held a leg and spread her wide, pushing with all our strength against her pushing, and her husband sternly counting one, two, three, telling her to focus harder. We looked into her then. We couldn't get our eyes out of that place. We forget the vagina, all of us. What else could explain our lack of awe, our lack of reverence? I was there when the doctor reached in with Alice in Wonderland spoons, and there as her vagina became a wide operatic mouth singing with all its strength. First the little head, then the gray flopping arm, then the fast swimming body swimming quickly into our weeping arms. I was there later when I just stood and faced her vagina. I let myself see her all spread, completely exposed, mutilated, swollen, and torn, bleeding all over the doctor's hands who was calmly sewing her there. I stood and her vagina suddenly became a wide, red, pulsing heart. The heart is capable of sacrifice. So is the vagina. The heart is able to forgive and repair. It can change its shape to let us in. It can expand to let us out. So can the vagina. It can ache for us and stretch for us, die for us and bleed us into this difficult, wondrous world. I was there in the room. I remember.
My revolution begins in the body. It isn't waiting anymore. My revolution does not require approval or permission. It happens because it has to happen in each neighborhood, village, city, or town. Gatherings of tribes, fellow students, women at the market, on the bus. It may be gradual and soft. It may be spontaneous and loud. It may be happening already. It may be found in your closet, your drawers, your gut, your legs, your multiplying cells in the naked mouth of taut nipples and overflowing breasts. My revolution is swelling from this insatiable drumming between my legs. My revolution is willing to die for this. My revolution is ready to live big. My revolution is overthrowing the state of mind called patriarchy. My revolution, it won't be choreographed, though it begins with a few familiar steps. My revolution is not violent, but it doesn't shy away from dangerous edges where fierce displays of resistance tumble into something new. My revolution is in this body. These hips, atrophied by misogyny, and this jaw, wired mute by hunger and atrocity. My revolution is connection, not consumption, passion, not profit, orgasm, not ownership. My revolution is of the earth and will come from her, for her, because of her. It understands that every time we frack or drill or burn or violate the layers of her sacredness, we violate the soul of our future. My revolution is not ashamed to press my body down on her mud floor. in front of banyan, cypress, pine, oak, kalyan, chestnut, mulberry, redwood, sycamore trees, to bow shamelessly to shocking yellow birds and rose blue setting skies, heart exploding purple bougainvillea and aqua sea. My revolution gladly kisses the feet of mothers and nurses and servers and cleaners and healers and nannies and all who are life and give life. My revolution is on its knees, on my knees, to every holy thing and to those who carry empire-made burdens in and on their heads, backs, and hearts. My revolution demands abandon, expects the original, relies on troublemakers, anarchists, poets, seers, shamans, sexual explorers, tricksters, mystic travelers, tightwad walkers, and all those who go too far and feel too much. My revolution shows up unexpectedly. It's not naive, though it believes in miracles. It cannot be categorized, targeted, branded, or even located. It offers prophecy, not prescription. It's a product of mystery and ecstatic joy. It requires listening. It's not centralized, though we all know where we're going. It happens in stages and all at once. It happens where you live and everywhere. It understands that divisions are diversions. It requires sitting still and staring deep into my eyes. Go ahead. Love.
Our 2015 Vagina Monologues director, Simona Gamonte. That these stories from across the world are portrayed and performed in a manner that honors all of the courageous women that you have heard about tonight. It is not an easy task, and that doesn't even begin to mention the fact that she had to organize around 20 busy students' schedules. So she has been an incredible director to work with, and there's no way we could have had this show without her, so thank you. I would like to thank the beautiful women standing behind me. It is not as easy as it looks to moan in front of roughly 160 people, or be vulnerable, or talk about issues of rape and sexual exploitation and violence. But these women volunteered to be vulnerable tonight for the sake of advocacy and awareness. To be vulnerable in front of you all, to shed light on what it's like to be a woman in today's society. I'm honored to have been able to work with all of these selfless, beautiful, and hardworking women. I also want to say thank you to our volunteers, Marie, Vlad, and Kostya, who helped with tickets. As well as set up for tonight's event. A special thank you to Daniel for running the lights. Could not have put on tonight's performance without all of their help. Lastly, I would like to thank you all for coming out tonight. Each one of you made it possible to donate approximately 320,000 forints thus far to Hanum Homeless Women for Each Other, which is an absolutely incredible accomplishment for mostly a bunch of rich in personality, low in income master's students. Donation bucket in the back if you feel led to donate any extra funds to the women who have stories that are not so different from the ones you have heard here tonight. Because all of you lovely individuals came to the finale performance, we would like to invite you all to an after party with the cast at Soda. There's no admission free and the DJ will start around 10 p.m. If you would like to join us, you will be able to find the address for any Google Maps needs on the back of tonight's program. Thank you all and have a wonderful evening.